way through the crowd to try to stop him, but I was too late. He was already juggling by the time I got there, with the two balls and the compass. For a while, it looked fine. He was just juggling brilliantly. I had seen him juggling as many as four balls before, many a time, and he had hardly ever dropped one. I am sure it was because of all the hullabaloo the crowd was making that Marlene was becoming a little unsettled. She was wafting her ears and swaying from side to side, a sure sign that she was agitated. Then she lifted her trunk and shifted towards suddenly, throwing Carly off balance. I saw the compass flying high into the air. I dashed forward to try to catch it. I think I knew I was hopeless, but that it was way out of my reach, that there was no way I could make it. I tripped then and fell heavily. When I looked up, I saw that Hans had caught the compass and was holding it in his cupped hands. I was just relieved that it was not broken. The children were all clapping and cheering. I had noticed before that Hans never smiled, and he was not smiling now either, despite all the applause. He was turning the compass over in his hands, examining it carefully. He flicked it open and then looked up at Carly. "Where did you get this?" he demanded. "It is not German. This looks to me like a British compass, or American. A German compass would have an O for Ost, and this is an E. Ost in English is East, and there is English writing on it too. Where did you get it?" A sudden silence had descended on the stable yard. Carly, for once, had nothing to say. His eyes met mine. He was begging for help, but I couldn't think of anything to say either. "I asked you where you got it from," Hans asked again. "From me." It was Muddy's voice from behind me. She had Peter with her as she came through the crowd towards me. She put her arm around my shoulder. My husband gave it to me, a gift. He is fighting the Russians now, but at the beginning of the war, he was in France, in Normandy. He told me he got off a British pilot who had been shot down. It was his, and now it is mine, she said. I admired her so much at that moment. I knew she was brave, but had no idea she could be this inventive. Hans hesitated for a long time. I could see he had his doubts, that he still was not sure he believed her. "Thank you," Muddy went on, "for catching it. I mean, I would hate to have seen it lying there smashed on the ground. It was the last gift I had from my husband. It has brought us all the way from Dresden, you know? So for lots of reasons, you can see it is very precious to me, to my whole family. Thank you." Hans seemed more satisfied now. He thought for a while, then nodded slowly before handing it over to her at last. "It's not a toy," he said. "I do not think little children should be playing with such a thing." "I quite agree," Muddy replied, with a shrug and a smile. "But you know how children are. Don't you worry. I will see to it that he does not do it again. I promise you." She looked up at Carly. She did not have to pretend to be angry with him. Carly knew it. He was looking quite shamefaced and sheepish. "Carly, you will get down off that elephant this minute and come with me." Peter went to help him down, and once we had seen Marlene safely back in her stable, we all walked away. But I could feel Hans' eyes on us all the time. After supper that same evening, the Countess got up and clapped her hands to quiet everyone down. "What many of you do not know," she began, "is that the school children we have with us are from a chapel choir in Dresden. I have asked them if they would sing something for us. In these terrible times, I think it is only music that can bring us some joy and peace of mind. Only last Christmas, they told me they sang the Christmas Oratorio by Johann Sebastian Bach, who is for me the greatest German who ever lived. They have very kindly agreed to sing some of it for us now." As they were singing, I found I could lose myself completely in the music, that I could forget all the dreadful things that were going on in the world. I felt cocooned in this heavenly music. It seemed to warm me all the way through. It was a glow that lingered long after the singing had finished. I was still hearing it again in my head when we were back upstairs in our attic room that night, huddled under our blankets. The music had affected us all just as deeply, I think. We could talk about nothing else. Even Muddy had stopped being angry with Carly about the compass incident. "I only wish Poppy could have been there with us to hear his beloved box," she said. "He would have loved it so much." We were almost asleep when the door opened and the light of the lantern danced into the room. It was the Countess. She crouched down to speak to us, talking in a hushed voice. "I am afraid there is trouble," she said. "Hans is a good man. He has been with me for over 40 years now. He was in the last war and is a loyal German, as I am. But he and I, we have different loyalties, different ideas. I have learned that he intends to go to the police about the compass. Yes, he has told me everything that happened. I tried to persuade him not to, but he insisted that it was his patriotic duty. I am afraid he did not believe your story, and I have to say, neither do I. But I have another reason to doubt you. Your son," she is looking directly at Peter now. "How you speak, this has been troubling me for quite a while now. When you talk, you sound to me like an American. You see, I have relatives in America, and when they speak German, they speak just like you. My American nephew would have been about your age. It is so sad, so ironic, so stupid. He was my sister's son, half American, half German. He joined the American army and now lies dead in Normandy, killed by a German bullet. She turned to Muddy. There is something else I do not quite believe about this son of yours. I hear that he has asthma, and that is why he has been excused military service. But I have been watching him, and I have seen no sign of this asthma. In fact, he looks to me like to be as strong as an ox. Hans believes he may be an enemy pilot, a bomber pilot, and I think he may be right. If he is, and you are caught, then we all know what will happen, not just to him, but to you also, all of you. I would not want to see that happen. Muddy tried to interrupt, but the Countess would not let her. I think it is best that you should leave, and right away. You will have your reasons for doing what you are doing, and I am sure they are good reasons, but I do not want to know them. The less I know, the better. Your little boy looks to me as if he is quite well enough to travel now. Once Hans has alerted the police, they will not take long to get here. That is for sure. So I think you should go tonight, now, before it is too late. I shall, of course, tell the police that I am sure Hans' suspicions are quite groundless. But when you go, if you do not mind, I should like you to do something for me, something that is very important. I want you to take those children with you, the choir. They have no one to look after them anymore. Their choir master was killed, and several of the children, too, on their way here. I want you to let them travel with you to look after them. Would you do that? I know it is a lot to ask, but I have seen how much they love that elephant of yours. They will go willingly with you. They will go where she goes. I cannot keep them here forever. I should like to, but I just do not have the room. As you can see, I am overcrowded as it is, and more come every day. I will give you enough food for you and for them to get on your way. She spoke in English now to Peter and looking him in the eye. Tell me the truth now, young man. Am I right? Are you what I think you are? American? Canadian, Peter replied. RAF. I was close enough then, she said, in German again. The war is coming to an end very soon. I think the Americans must be very close now. It will all be over, but too late for my husband, sadly. And since I know your truth, I will tell you mine. A few months ago, my husband took part in a plot to assassinate Hitler. My husband was a good German, a good officer who believed we had been led down the wrong road, a terrible road into this war, and he just wanted it to stop. The only way to do it, he thought, was to kill Hitler. So he and his friends tried to do it, tried to end the suffering. They failed, and he died for what he believed in. I believe what he believed, that the suffering must end. This is why I am doing what I do now. This is why your secret will be my secret. So gather your things and come downstairs, but hurry. I have already assembled the children and have given each of them enough food for a few days. It is all I can spare. Be quick now. The farther you are gone from here before dawn, the better. She left us then before Muddy or any of us could say a word of thanks. We dressed quickly, gathered our things, and made our way downstairs. The children were all waiting in the hall, the Countess too. We were saying our goodbyes when the front door opened and Hans came in. He was not alone. He had an army officer with him and several soldiers, their rifles pointing right at us.